And Matt Daneman, business reporter for the Democrat and Chronicle, joins us. Great to see you.
Good to be here. Less than 2 weeks left till shopping for Christmas. Hint,
okay.
Hint.
No, I got you taken care of. Don't worry. Let's start out with a little bit of court action on Kodak today.
Yeah, actually, some interesting developments just a couple hours ago with Eastman Kodak. Down in bankruptcy court in New York City, received court approval for the $830 million package of loans that Kodak has lined up to sort of get it through bankruptcy, out of bankruptcy, and really to be sort of the financing and the pot of cash to keep it afloat for quite a bit of time to come. Interesting, sort of expected to happen, mm-hmm. not really controversial, the approval itself. The really interesting thing was what was said in court about how there's a variety of lenders really sort of lining up to get Kodak cash, aside from the lenders that are all part of the package, a variety of hedge funds and private equity firms. Barclays out of the United Kingdom is also put forward its own package of funding that might replace the $830 million.
So what's that say to you?
What it says and what the judge made a point of saying in court is that it really seems to indicate some optimism amongst a number of lenders that Kodak actually, there's something there, there's something of value, that Kodak has a chance of coming out of bankruptcy and having some success behind it. It's really an interesting sort of, at least one sign of optimism about Kodak's direction, the fact so many lenders are willing to put hundreds of millions of dollars behind this company, and others are looking to get a piece of the action too. Kodak's still talking about first half of 2013 coming out of bankruptcy, but within a matter of a couple weeks, Kodak indicated we might start seeing some details of what that sort of post-bankruptcy company will look like in terms of projections and things of that nature. So a lot of momentum going on, a lot of action about to commence in terms of Kodak in the sort of the reboot, the 2.0 Kodak.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's interesting. And speaking of the millions of dollars coming in, the Finger Lakes Regional Economic Development Council expecting to hear something fairly soon about their proposed.
Yeah, actually the big hullabaloo that the state does when it hands out these economic development packages to the various regions, it'll be on Wednesday, I believe, in the same format as last year, with sort of almost a lottery-like announcement where they open envelopes and reveal packages of, you know, the southern tier gets X tens of millions. Mm-hmm. And the Finger Lakes region gets X tens of millions. If you remember last year, the Finger Lakes region got 60-some million dollars.
Somewhat a lot of money, but not happy.
A lot of money by my standards and your standards, by Finger Lakes region standards, somewhat of a disappointment. They had been hoping to be one of the forefront packages that got closer to $100 million. If whatever money the Rochester region receives, it'll be used for anything from economic development issues to housing sorts of issues. Eastman Business Park, again, being one of the primary parts of the sort of the want list that the Finger Lakes region put forward to the state. Also things like U of R's College Town and U of R and IBM and their joint supercomputer project, a variety
of things. A lot of the projects that were in the first round of funding.
Very much so.
Any sense that, is there optimism that this time the Finger Lakes region will be one of the big winners?
Yeah, if you listen to the people who are part of the Finger Lakes Regional Economic Development Council sort of folks like Joel Seligman at U of R, like Danny Wegman of Wegmans, they're all saying the right things of, oh, we think we stand a really good chance.
You just don't know.
Everybody says right. That, though. And when the governor was here back in November touring this region, as he's toured all the regions, you know, saying all the right things of, oh, you know, a lot of opportunities and a mm-hmm. well-put-together package.
He was saying that in every region, so you got to wait and see.
If he told us region, boy, you guys stink, that would be the noteworthy.
About 30 seconds left, Bausch Lomb.
Maybe a new owner for Bausch Lomb might be in the works. A number of reports that Warburg Pincus, the private equity group that bought B&L back in 2007 for about $4.5 billion, $4.6 billion, has now hired Goldman Sachs to shop it around. A number of suitors are being talked about sort of in the rumor mill, including Abbott and Merck. If a B&L is sold to one of these firms as opposed to, say, an initial public offering and going back public itself, might not be the greatest news for the Rochester region. If I'm Abbott, hypothetically, right. And I'm B&L, do I need all these back office folks? Could be some bad jobs news.
All right. Well, thanks for coming in today.
Good Always to see a pleasure. You.
Matt Daneman, business reporter for the Democrat and Chronicle, and I'm Julie Philipp. Join me next week when we have another holiday special. We'll be showing you part of our Need to Know Rochester documentary, Garth and Wynton, The Project. It follows Rochester choreographer Garth Fagan and composer Wynton Marcellus as they collaborate on a piece for the first time in more than 20 years. I'll see you then.